This movie is Western nostalgia and Eastern mystique put together.
It looks like a Western as perceived through Eastern eyes as a genre.
I don't exactly know how to pitch this film. I mean, because it has sort of a mishmash of everything.
Nothing is too raw.
It does not have a genre because it encompasses too many different genres.
It could be perceived as a Western. It could be perceived as a
banquet. Very full of ingredients and delicious.
Eclectic would be the word.
The word du jour.
The word du jour for this film, eclectic. Eclectically kind of fractured.
Yeah, this movie is the mixture of everything, East meets West. Like the convergence of everything possible, that was the idea.
I look at him and say, you know, Singh, you're a sick, sick bastard.
A hard on for a skull. Yeah, that is one.
And then, on the other hand, there's a sort of delicate poetry.
It reads like a great fable, and it's so pure, and it's got so many beautiful and quite disturbing and really confronting images that you think, wow, this is, it's fresh.
Singmu at first talked about wanting an anime feel, to live in magic art, in this beautiful light. It's always, you know, everything's backlit, whichever way you're looking. Working with Brendan Heffernan, who was concept artist, every time we'd go into a new concept piece, it was about where's the magic? You know, let's find the magic.
We tried and actually got very close to producing it in the US in one of the southwestern states, which is where it's really set.
And obviously, there are some greens and mountains nearby, and that's something we really didn't want to have in our background. So we were thinking of covering the whole existing town with a huge green screen. It was a crazy idea, of course. And then, hang on a second, if we are going to do this, why can't we just move into a studio?
We all agreed that the best place to make this movie, in fact, was in New Zealand, where we could fashion this fable here on a soundstage.
In a lot of ways, it would be much smarter to try and design sets that had holes in them, as it were, so that you could add an environment.
Moving the whole thing into the studio meant comfortable working condition, but it was a disastrous decision for the lighting point of view. Because you can never ever copy the burning sun in the desert. In this studio environment, in the beginning, I thought everything would be so easy for me.
But we can also play a little bit with where we are width-wise in the street, depending.
But it was way too much, I think.
And then we come back around, go back up the size flute, and then come back down. When we come back down, we're back up.
I've never had that much green in front of me.
So it seems like you're almost forced to go just about straight up.
It was really difficult for me to imagine something which is not actually there.
All right, well, we can just do some pretty simple math, right? Well, the visual style is an interesting question. Just a sense that we're living in a storybook. We're living in a kid's fantasy. On one side, you have a traditional film where you build all the sets, you point a camera, and you shoot. And the other side, where you don't build anything, you throw up green screens, you design everything virtually. We knew we were going to be somewhere in the middle, so it was a few weeks and actually a few months to sort of sort out exactly where that middle ground was going to be.
Well, we're building all the components now, but we were meant to be striking Studio 5 on Monday, but the second units are in there now.
The art department has a very close relationship with the visual effects department. There's a lot of conversation. Models are discussed heavily in terms of what we'll provide and what they'll provide, what we expect to see on set at any given time when we're looking in each direction. We have about 120 people in our department, encompassing construction, scenic artists, special effects, horse department, greenies, props, set dressing, you name it. Everything you see on screen, we look after. In a film like this, which is studio-based, it's a total art department environment. The toughest part for us has been the schedule, really. We only have 6 stages to shoot in. We have 45 sets to provide. So it's pretty fast turnaround and some pretty big sets. We've got the whole of the carnival, obviously. We've got various ends of the main street. The turnaround time's certainly been an issue on this one. I've found the whole project to be incredibly enjoyable. The whole aging process, the amount we're able to break sets down is so much fun. Just a variety of techniques we're able to employ to get the job done.
I think the excitement in creating something like this is about something different and something that hopefully will be unique.
This scene, we've separately worked on movement sounds, the whoosh of the knife, then the knife impacting, separate water sounds, and then obviously the sword whoosh, the sword hit, the slicing through flesh, and the movement. So we're basically, at this point, we're consolidating the amount of material we have, but we're keeping elements still separate so that in the final mix we can still shape it moment by moment. With a lot of the action, it's not a simple attack, it's speed ramped and it's cut from 3 perspectives, so it's really playing with time. I've taken a really huge bell sound, metal bell, and reversed it so that it's sort of like this building momentum sound. But it's also being constantly aware of what the composer's doing. You know, sometimes that involves, pitch shifting sound effects so that they're in key with music.
In the meantime, we also had to budget what it was going to cost to do all this stuff. And that took us, we're still doing it, actually. One of the interesting challenges we have is we have a main character who doesn't have any dialogue for the first 30 pages, and he shows very little emotion. And the only thing we really have to connect with him is really his violence becomes his art. The way we can help with that is to design a palette and design a frame that helps the audience experience his mood.
Yang is a man who spends his life becoming the greatest swordsman in the world. But when he reaches his goal, he faces an identity crisis.
The hero makes his choice about what he's going to do because of a baby's laugh.
The unspoken, central, most important character of the film is this very young baby.
One more step! Get your suit!
And through her eyes, we're watching what adults do when they go off the deep end.
When I first decided to put the baby in this action film, everybody said no, because baby and the animal is something you're supposed to avoid, especially in this kind of complicated movie. But it turns out that directing that baby is one of the best things happened in this film for me.
Well, the baby is the star of this show, you know, and this baby steals every scene it's in. A remarkable baby. Cut. She's got 4 teeth now. Do you know
is
that?
She?
4 teeth. She was standing up yesterday.
Mm.
Wonderful baby.
She has been growing with the film progressing from sitting there and crawling around and take her first couple of steps. It's a really special time for her. She enjoys filming so much. We just can tell every time she's on set, she's happy and she's trying to make contact with everyone on set. Yeah, they just absolutely adore her and she feels very comfortable with them. And sometimes I think she's not just my baby, but everyone else on set.
I might steal your baby.
Okay.
Yay! Yay! At the end.
Yeah, it was like a miracle. And we all really loved her.
Yeah, first four takes, she was absolutely consistent with her continuity, and then on the last one, she decided to give her director, Sonu, an option in the edit. So very, very generous performance yet again.
She was the best actor or actress. don't tell this to Jeffrey or anybody else, but they cannot compete with Annalene. She was that perfect, and this was one of the best choice I made.
Thank you.
She's much better looking. Oh.
Well, it's a story about this guy who's the greatest swordsman in the world. And he defeats all his enemies on the other side, except it's this one baby. And he just can't kill no baby. So he decides to take this baby and come to America and try to make a life for him.
He leaves Asia, hoping to make a new life for himself as a humble laundryman in the American West. There, he meets people who help him to find himself.
Our first candidate was Dongun. He is really modest and a humble guy.
I mean, people gonna just love him, especially the ladies, you know, because he's just got that look about him, you know.
Thank you. He's very handsome. Like me when I was young.
What I see is a committed actor, an actor who understands stillness.
He came with a kind of blank sheet and let us develop and create things around him.
It seems like he's not moved by the process of filming. He stands his ground, he listens, he follows instructions, and I wish my team was like that sometimes.
Watch me scare him.
I felt very strongly that we needed to go back to Asia and find a fight choreographer that was going to help me really create the style of the fighting in this movie. I felt a bastardized Fijian interpretation of martial arts was not going to do us any favours. We found Yuji Shimomura from Japan.
Any talk about all the problems that you're causing this morning? You know, Yuji, who speaks no English, but he speaks broken action director English.
Ready, action!
I used to take martial arts back in the early 80s, and I have a black belt, and watching all this action, it's just great. I'm like a little kid in the candy store, because this is just exciting to me.
Yang doesn't waste his energy. We're going on the philosophy of one strike, one kill.
Cut! いいですね. いいですね. うん. Yeah, 좋아요.
One of the challenging things about this film is trying to keep things working to schedule. You're using a lot of pneumatic gear. There's water, there's harnesses, there's costumes. Just trying to keep things in perspective. It's only day one.
We can basically fire them at up to about 600-700 PSI and land them through an exhaust system. And my job down here is just to make sure all the settings are right, make sure all the rigging gear and all the pulleys and all that are running clean, and watching out for wear and tear and stuff like that, and making sure it's all happening safely, really, for those guys.
On some shows, you're lucky to have those sort of gags, one of those in a movie. We seem to be having those three times a week.
Yeah. You all right, buddy?
Everybody set. We'll do another.
And we are often looking forward to days when there's no stunts.
number two came here and just flying back here and ready to attack.
And then when he gets killed, he jumps up to the post.
And stabbing and go.
Go, okay. So after they exit, yes, who's the first one to attack Yang?
Other guy.
Yeah, is it Clinton that's...
This is Matt.
Oh, just to keep him a little bit cool. Keep the flames off his skin as long as we can while we get to do it.
Pull this damn circus down! Burn it!
Put him out!
Oh, yeah.
Burn, baby, burn.
Ouch.
My character's name is Lynn. She's a knife thrower.
Throw.
But not a very good one.
You dead?
She's so difficult to describe because she's just out there. Like, it's a completely new woman.
One of the things that I said to her was that I'd like you to play it like a dirty boy for the first third of the movie before we suddenly see you transformed into a hooker.
Wear something nasty.
She really likes to get under the skin of the character. She said, how do I walk like a man? And I said, well, I think probably the best way is to put you in a pair of men's shoes.
I mean, like these shoes, for example, are actually probably a six size is too big for me. There's a real clomping, childlike, sort of tomboyish quality that comes along with that that helps create a character. First one, got it. Ha! Ha!
Uh-huh, yeah. Excitement.
Yeah.
Second one. Uh-uh. I'm not getting there, but, right.
Can she say shit? Can she say shit?
I don't know. Is it like...
We have a shit, yeah, in the script somewhere, but... I
say shit.
Shit.
Shit, okay.
Yeah, she's okay.
Especially, like... I arrived in New Zealand about 3 weeks before I was meant to start shooting. Most of it was for stunts. I just remember thinking, oh, I don't know if I can do this. You know, I got so nervous. I had so little time to learn how to do it. We have an incredible stunt team, incredible choreographer, Yuji. He'll show me a move, and I'll go, oh, okay, I think I can do that. You know, and then it's like that's when you know someone's really good at something, because you get there and you think,
sorry,
what did you do? You know, just because it looks so easy.
I watched a cut of her doing the saloon fight the other day, and some people commented that, that was good work by the stunt double, and I think Kate poked her head up. That was me.
That's good.
Kate is young, smart, beautiful, and kind. She's my first English movie partner. I will never forget her.
You know, he really is just a top-notch human being. He's just such a gentleman in every way.
Their dynamic together is probably the most beautiful or handsomest screen couple I've seen in a long time.
I'll win.
No. Until your enemies are hard to stop, you have not won.
Is that so?
Just try and keep the answers short.
Okay. Yeah.
Right. We're like a graceful swan, really, aren't we, Bob? As I'm gliding along, and there's underneath the water is this guy paddling like mad. He's the duck's feet, really, aren't you?
Yes.
And he makes me look good.
Pretty much a majority of the show, all the costumes have been made from the ground up. We dye fabric, we fit it, alter it, and then we take it into an area called breakdown.
And we basically trash it.
They'll start filing it, they'll put dirt on it, then you have to set the dirt.
It's part of their character. What you're trying to do is to take it from being a costume to making it clothes.
You know, we're creating a story with the clothing. It comes through to us brand new and it goes out looking disgusting.
Final stage of breakdown, so just some dust, some extra grease, some sweat, just before they go on set.
We kind of want you to be able to wash your hands, need to wash your hands after you've seen this film. You have to wash your hands very often, don't you?
I do.
So by this time, when he enters the town, Slugpug and Rogue is already behind him.
And finally, Yang arrives here, open up that door. There is nothing behind. It's just the facade. Ron is sleeping here. This is your nap place.
Hey, Johnny. I don't like your stinking face.
Never in a million years did I, as an Australian actor, did I ever think I'd be offered a Western. And I'm playing Ron, who is town drunk.
I was most delighted when Jeffrey was cast. He's one of the greatest actors today. I couldn't believe I was actually acting with him.
You, I knew it was trouble the moment you walked into this.
Often, the costume designer is the first person you really meet up with in the pre-production process.
I first went to meet Jeffrey Rush in Melbourne, and I took him a few silly sketches, and he immediately attempted to recreate the drawing. What you notice about Jeffrey is that he is, at that stage, he is searching for a character.
That was a really great starting point, but we knew that later in the script he was going to have to emerge as a forgotten sniper gunslinger.
So when the read is open, smart people will know that, goddamn, he's the man.
There she is, the circumciser.
I said, there's just got to be a moment where I'm walking down the street with the circumciser, and I sense that music should probably swell underneath this moment. Once I rediscovered my old clothes, the moment I put that outfit on, I go back 20 years.
Jeffrey Rush, who I'm a great admirer of, I have one scene with Jeffrey where we're both drunk. Now, that wasn't much of a stretch.
I become the butt of the Colonel's joke where he whips me around the neck and mocks me by having me dragged around the town out in the desert. The stunt guy who was doubling for me, Tim, did the most amazing. I think he ate about 5 pounds of sand. But of course, you know that you need a couple of well-placed hero shots. I'm glad I didn't have to actually have a horse pulling me, because they don't listen when the AD says cut.
Cut? I find the smallest bit of condor crap in my fancy duds. Oh, we're gonna be in...
The script calls for 8-Ball, who is this black little person. And we thought, well, there's only one person that can play that role.
8-Ball is a very lovable guy. He's a strong individual. I think he has to be strong for the rest of the people that's in the Carney gang.
Well, the Carneys, you know, we tried to give, I think the thing, I don't know, can I butt in, Bob?
You go.
Samu said, you know, is that I haven't written any dialogue for these people, so you better do it with the costumes.
Are you ready to bury the bastard? Yeah!
It really does feel like it's like this beautiful, dysfunctional family, you know, and... And there's a certain feral quality to everybody. They've only got each other, so if you imagine just living only with your family in the middle of nowhere, it gets pretty brutal.
I've gotten into the habit of just, you know, not washing it off.
It's easy.
Just coming to work. Maintaining the makeup throughout the day is obviously as simple as it sounds, literally keeping the look the same throughout the day, because it's deteriorating constantly, especially in the heat of studios. But there is also the continuity of the makeup throughout our shooting day. Obviously, we're not shooting in order. Sometimes the scenes will be changing backwards and forwards to different looks depending on where they've come from in the story.
I'm just putting more colour on it because on the stage there's a lot of yellow in the light, so it gets rid of all the red tone. If Danny didn't wash it, it would stay on for a week.
Usually the case.
But otherwise, I think mostly it's just about being around a good crew and doing some makeup is always fun.
Yeah, that's pretty sufficiently grisly, I reckon.
It might just be a bit watery just right there.
What have we learnt about beards? Well, that they are high maintenance.
Usually working on facial hair, you have a beard line to work with. But on a female, obviously, you don't, so you're actually creating that.
I really don't know how men have them all the time. You know, they take a long time to put on.
Bob had this great idea that in the flashback, the bearded lady only has a moustache. I think that's still in, Bob.
Yeah, good.
It's like being at the beach, being on that sand. It's incredible, because you can feel when they go off. The lights go off, and it's just like the sun closing down.
I said I promise not to use it on her face afterwards.
Esmeralda's weapon of choice, I thought, would actually be part of a costume, because, you know, I have that fantastic fan costume. But in the end, my weapon of choice was double-barrel shotgun. And that was the best thing of all, shooting hell riders.
Come safe.
Getting ready to die. Again.
Dying of the day.
That's the trigger. So as soon as I push that, that'll blow.
Okay, we see that.
I have my food.
Uh-huh.
I'm cleaning my. The guys are bringing you in. And then, you hungry?
You hungry?
She doesn't answer me. The colonel comes across a young girl who he fancies because her teeth are clean. So he attempts to rape her. And she, as a way to escape, throws boiling oil on his face. He, from that point, has to wear a mask to cover his disfigurement.
That's better.
You will walk away from this movie absolutely hating Danny Houston, hating the Colonel.
He's quite difficult to define in a sense. He's larger than life.
What did Santa bring you, little boy?
And also he's...
Cat got your tongue?
Quite mad.
He has to make this jump from being a young villain to a kind of damaged and bitter villain. One of my team is a wonderful guy called Wild Man Matt Morris. And Wild Man is a third generation leather worker.
This is where I make the masks and that for Danny. These are all leather masks that are molded up to Danny's face.
It distorts the real side of my face. And the mask side of the face is actually quite tranquil. The limitations that the mask has imposed upon me as an actor have created the character and the way the character moves.
I find the relationship between Lynn and the Colonel incredibly interesting in that their relationship has been a very strange obsession for one another. So when they finally come face to face...
You met before?
Pretty intense.
No, we haven't. This is bound to be a night you will never forget.
I think we've created a rather strange scene together.
Oh, you have good teeth. I like that.
Colonel, as you unwrap me, I'm sure you will find there's a whole lot more of me to like.
Oh, I have no doubt of that.
Though I may be young, I was hoping you could teach me a thing or two.
Life's best lessons tend to hurt.
There's one scene where I'm wearing a garter belt, and she thinks that I'm getting undressed, and she opens this sort of blind thing, and I'm there ready.
Toes.
The revenge is ever so sweet for him. He remembers the way that she smelt.
The moment I smelt your neck, it all came flooding back. Changed my life, little girl. And now I'm going to change yours.
And when you hear him under his horrible mask, groan and grunt and taunt, it is delicious.
And Kate was a really, really good sport. I could really get quite sort of disgusting and repulsive or around her neck area and dribble.
Hard on him for a skull.
It's hilarious because he plays the most evil character. I'll really have to, you know, really focus to get myself into the headspace because it's like Denny, you know? It's hard to imagine him sometimes as this, like, really evil, horrible person because he's just really wonderful.
Gentlemen, escort the lady to bed.
It's great to do your own stunts and to work with stunts closely. You just feel more confident as an actor if the images that are being used are yours. But also you depend greatly on the stuntman to double you, to create speed when it's necessary to be amped up a little bit.
Bro, all you can give us, okay? Out, up and out.
And have them, in a sense, make you look great.
Have some quiet things, and one, action!
Okay, good.
Turn over.
What I was at times slightly perplexed by was why everybody wanted the baby not to be scared. I mean, I'm aiming a gun at its temple.
One more step. It's your soup.
I don't want to, guys, I think it's fine if the baby's crying. I think it might be odd if the baby, in fact, is not.
This here is when the Hell Riders first turn up and we reveal the Hell Riders charging. We wanted real horses and the energy you have from horses at full gallop, so we shot them outside.
The Hell Riders are like gangster bikies on horseback. There are some symbols in there slightly because they've all come from being like mercenaries from the Civil War.
Hell Riders are my specialty. I'm a Hell Rider myself, and like I take on a character when I get a job. I like to really immerse myself into the work. Now this particular piece here was made for our biggest man that we've had on the job. He's about 7 foot tall.
The Hell Riders have a lot of makeup. They're very grotty, very dirty, and very sweaty, and that takes quite a lot of maintenance.
For the Hell Riders, we wanted a bit more of a football approach. I guess you can say they're more like rubbish bins. A car comes through and hits them, they just bounce. On the other hand, you've got these sad flutes who are nasty in their own way, but they have a sense of order.
Action!
They're trained to kill as opposed to people who have been rebels.
Yes. My name is Tilo. And in this film, I act as Satis Fruit.
Ready?
あの空いてるところを埋めるっていうことでいいんですか、それとも一列に並んでる方がいいんですか。ポジションは変わらないっていうことですか。はい。
Linear meters of green screen, and we still couldn't stay on it. We had a crew that just put those little red tracking markers on. That was a full-time job of like three people.
Yes, those red crosses actually are for tracking. The tracking software actually works better if there's a grid. And what it does is it finds color difference. And if we have red against green, then we can tell it, okay, choose that specific point and lock onto it. People don't actually realize how important the tracking is, because you could have an environment that looks fantastic. If it doesn't match the camera, the virtual camera doesn't match the live camera, it'll start wobbling, and then you've lost it. It'll look completely fake. So the shot itself is Ron and Slug are on top of the Ferris wheel, and so as soon as the Hell Riders charge in, Ron fires at the dynamite, hits the dynamite stick, and the whole thing explodes, and death and destruction ensues. Hopefully this will work.
This film, considering it has 1,400 VFX shots, meant that a lot of the shots didn't have any backgrounds. They were just shot over green. Sometimes we'd have to mock up a rough idea of what was actually happening in the background, you know, so we could understand how to play the scene in terms of timing. Okay, this one here is when Ron and Slug want to blow up some of the Hell Riders. But once we put the sound effects and all the finished pictures in, you get an idea of how it looks. Makes a bit more sense.
Good, thank you. Comments, Javier?
As a film composer, making this will involve and playing with Korean music, with contemporary music, with electric guitars, modern sounds, electronic sounds. The love theme in the film is a little mandolin playing a thin note. Mandolin is a very humble instrument, and if you play one note without a pick, the sound is really thin and really poor, no? And at the same time, going to the range, to the score music, which is, involves a big orchestra like the one we're recording to.
That's good, yeah.
You know, to do this kind of movie with this much work, for the money that we have, it was just not doable 2 or 3 years ago.
We split the show up into three main parts. The town we gave to a company here in New Zealand. The carnival we gave to a company in Los Angeles. Everything else, the others, which included the Asian environments and then, you know, the desert environments, we gave to a Korean facility. Very early on, we realized there was even more subcategories. So now we're looking at 7 vendors split between 4 different time zones. So it's very interesting to try and bring all these different aspects and different elements and all make the same movie, because at the end of the day, we all need to look uniform and perfect in the same way.
And we planned it out pretty...
Okay, give 1%
luck. 1%
luck? Okay.
1% luck.
1.5.
Yeah, no, one. Okay. I think I'll give one. 1% luck.
I think everyone bonded into a troop very swiftly, because there was just great off-camera, between-take friendliness, you know, rapport that was established very quickly.
I'll try and find you, and if I find you, I'll cut you.
Do it
twice, and I'll stab you in the ground.
Ooh, did you come running along here, or did you come through the middle?
I come through here.
Let's go to places, please. First position's back. Again, there'll be gunfire, perhaps even a little more this time. Dragon's hot.
State 102 Hotel, take one.
Guns
Fuck.
And 3, 2, 1, and...
He's cutting 10 set flu, you know, very, we call it modified.
Mm-hmm.
And he's good. Mm. So you just look at him. It's love and hate.
Love and hate.
Yeah. And at that moment, one bullet is hitting you. And bullet.
Okay.
Bullet cannot kill you.
Okay. Not grab?
No. Okay. How about bite it?
Bite it.
The relations between Sethsfoot and Yan is something like a teacher with his protege. Sethsfoot treat him like his own blood.
Yeah.
We have action choreography team from Japan and some local people and Korean. It's kind of a combination.
Okay.
We always believe this is a teamwork, so we have a team spirit.
The people working on this film are from many different countries. It's sort of a mixture from all over the world. And that includes producers as well. Generally, filmmakers share things in common, but there is difference in culture. Hangar, who played the greatest swordsman, he has hurt himself while shooting. But nobody knew until he waited until the last take. He didn't want to let anybody else know that he's hurt. He knows that he's just here for a couple of days and he doesn't want to affect the production by delaying it. That's the kind of different understanding we're talking about.
By our perspective, it's almost a shyness. You really feel, my God, that person made very proper eye contact and bowed. We don't do that.
I think the more talents from a variety of different cultures, you have a better chance to make a better film.
It's been such an enjoyable collaboration. Every department on this film has been a pleasure.
And especially the AD.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Man, he's just so laid back. I've never seen an AD like him in my life. And the one thing I have to say to Chris is just keep on doing what you're doing. Don't let anybody change you.
How many ends have you got?
You speak to people the way you want them to speak to you, and he's just been great.
Well, I'm in the room here this morning. Let's go, please.
The crew in all departments here are laid back, relaxed, super professional, fun. That's a very good energy to have around the set.
There is something about the New Zealand sort of filmmaker that has brought amazing crews, even though they are making noise in the background, and I'll never forgive them for stepping on my line.
People are very friendly and also very hardworking and not spoiled yet.
I think they're wonderful and they respect the job. They make good movie. Like me, I make good movie.
I love these people, I love this country. Really, truly, I don't think I can meet a better crew. Truly, thank you for everything, and thank you, New Zealand.
Because in a sense, a film is an extended family.
If you ever do that again, if...
Don't shake the bed.
Hey, little brother, good to see you, man. Just gonna put your name on a rag.
You know, not only are we here in New Zealand, which has that reputation for being a little more informal, or mellow, or relaxed, or whatever word you want to use.
But it's still green.
It's also, you know, being an independent movie and not having a studio here is also, you know, tends to contribute to that.
Mm. Is it sweet?
Delicious, yeah. Very good.
You have the lucky luck. Danny, you've got
fresh.
It. Doing.
It's fresh. It tastes fresh.
I'm feeding him fresh blood.
And doing an independent film that's independently financed without major studio backing, we went through a period where our financing was a little bit dicey, and everybody stayed with us through a really trying period because they believed in the project, they believed in the script. To see these people so dedicated to a project is really heartwarming, and the entire crew deserves a really big hand for what they brought to the project.
Working with this specific crew was very inspiring, and they were extremely creative, no matter where they come from. I think we shared the same vision together, and they were extremely professional in their own field. It was a great experience for me, and I hope it was a great experience for them too.